Welcome back, everybody. Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca, a beautiful location, but the Monterey Peninsula is fabulous as well, and there is a great spot to go out and have a look. Now, by the way, the American Le Mans Series and Chevrolet Corvette have teamed up again for the sports car racing fans' dream, a grand prize of the all-new 2014 Chevrolet Corvette Stingray and an all-expense-paid VIP insider trip to the 24 hours of Le Mans. Go to racetowincorvette.com. And that's going to give you the chance to win the ultimate sports car fan's dream prize, a car and a trip to La Sarthe. Doesn't get much better than that. So I hustle over and do that. And we also want to give you a little bit of an update. Always a championship, Jeremy, within a championship in the American Le Mans Series presented by Tequila Patron, the Michelin Green X Challenge. It's a complex formula, but what it basically rewards is the car that runs cleanest, goes fast, and does everything in the most efficient manner possible in terms of green in the environment. And it's a very prestigious award within each of the classes. One given for GT, one given for the prototype category at each race, and of course the season championship.
Absolutely right. This car has won that award already this season. He's leading the race again now. And Johnny remained under pretty intense pressure from Lucas Lioba for quite a long time since that previous full course caution. But now, in the last couple of laps, he's eaten a little bit of an advantage of Johnny. And he'll be hoping to keep it that way. He puts one of the GTC cars himself down himself and the second place car into the air. Or does he? I guess not. Lucas Lure didn't like that idea at all. So dived down in there.
Yeah, I mean, Lure just made up that second and a half in that one short shot. Meanwhile, back to this great battle in LMP Challenge. Bicontinental, Junqueira still hanging on over Colin Brown. But for Colin Brown, he's got Luis Diaz. And oh, look at this moment. He almost got him now. He has to get down underneath that AXA Financial car, but it looked for a minute like he might have had him, and then a beautiful piece of driving by Johnny to use that car as a pick and trapped Lucas Lure, and Lucas couldn't use the momentum. Now Lucas trying to figure out a way, can I use underneath? Nope, not gonna happen here. And you can see the lights flashing for Lucas Lure. He's there, and boy, some great action here. But I have to say, watching what Neil Johnny is doing, when he catches a car, the timing of what he's doing with it, where he sweeps by that car, is awesome. But Lucas Lure, he is ready. And boy, he had a great run there, but just ran out of straight.
Yeah, whether they found something on this number six car since that last pit stop, did they change the tires? They did change the tires. Whether they changed the combat, we don't know. Yeah. But certainly Lucas is running very, very strong here. He's giving Neil Johnny all he can handle.
Well, if he lays back a little bit, gets the better run here. Well, Johnny's right behind that LMP Challenge car. But Johnny got off of that turn still very well. Now Lure, he's got to make his choice right now. And the best thing to do is stay down the inside. There he goes. Down into the Andretti hairpin. This is for the overall race lead, and we're seeing it from the GT cockpit.
We're just over the halfway mark in this race, and there is a margin between the two leaders. A few tenths of a second. Whoa! Wow! Lucas had a jump on the binders there going into turn four. Again, one of the Dempsey Del Piero GTC cars there. Making life a little bit difficult for Lucas Lure, but you know, he respects what these other guys are doing because he himself drove GT cars for a long, long time, so he knows how difficult it is sometimes to keep out of the way. So he jumped on the brakes there, cost him a couple of seconds, but he lives to fight another day, and so does the GTC Porsche.
Well, and the opportunity, you know, one of the things you go, what was that car thinking, not letting him do it? Well, that car, you're looking in a mirror, you see that Rebellion. Lure was so close behind him, you don't necessarily see that second car. You see the blue, you let that car go through, you turn in, and suddenly there's another car there. So it can happen. Now, back to this battle in GT Challenge, or excuse me, the Prototype Challenge. And Junqueira has a little bit of a margin right now, Jeremy, but this battle is intense. Colin Brown sneaks through. And no, Diaz got hung up just a little bit.
Yeah, and you know, the unwritten rule is the slower cars, they keep to their racing line. It's up to the faster guys to find their way around. So you know, there was absolutely nothing that GTC Porsche did, nor their down in either of those instances. And like I say, it's up to the faster guys to find their way around. So Lucas Lure, you know, he'll be momentarily frustrated, but not with anything other than the fact that he just lost a little bit of ground to Neil Johnny. But he knows full well that in another lap or two, the pendulum will swing the other way. Johnny will be held up, and maybe that on that occasion, he could take advantage. So, you know, it swings and roundabouts in endurance racing.
It does. And in the drivers' meetings and the like, I mean, the pro drivers at the top of the field tell the cars that are in a class that it's just slower in terms of performance potential for the car. Drive your line. And it's up to us and to figure the way by you.
And there's the PC cars working their way past number 23, Chief West AJR Ferrari. It's Bill Sweedler who's taken over now from Townsend Bell. He's doing a fine job, is Bill. He's not a professional driver by any shake of the imagination, but doing a really good, solid job in that car. He's turning 1 minute 26s, only maybe a second or so down on the leading cars, most of the leading cars in GT, and hanging on there is maybe 20 seconds or so behind the leaders in GT, but hanging in there really, really well indeed. And talking of the pace of GT cars, Bill Orbelin, we saw him a little while ago, almost a lap down, but not quite to the GT leaders. He's pulled out a little bit ahead of those guys. He's a little while ago, Bill Orbelin set the fastest lap that had been set so far in GT during this race. The only car so far down below 1 minute 24.
Then, of course, what they want to see, that number 55 team wants to see a caution. That would let him come back around, get on the tail end of things. And then, of course, with still plenty of race time to go, hour 52 plus minutes yet in this one. Oh, very slow there. Don't know what happened with Yanni. I think he may have been parked.
He's lost the lead, isn't he?
Wow.
Exactly what we're talking about. Yep. Lucas Lewis found a way past. So a new leader, lap 83 will be this time around.
Wow, big. He just was suddenly extremely slow. But it was already, that's what we saw when the camera picked him up. So I don't exactly know what happened. You would think maybe he just got completely parked in traffic, something like that.
Had a spin or something.
Yeah.
He lost a lot of ground there.
He lost
3 or 4 seconds at least. He's now a couple of seconds behind. He's turned at 1 minute 19 last time. It's Tom Kimber-Smith at turn 6 again.
Tough to tell from this angle, but it might well be.
Tom Kimber-Smith, he was hanging on the lead lap, 7th place in the GT class.
All right, copy. We'll send help.
From Patrick Long. Frustration there for Tom Kimber-Smith.
Chatting on the radio with the team. Oh, it's in the approach to the corkscrew. Boy, if he can't get moving on his own, I would think this has to be the caution. And it comes. There it is. The indication from race control. And a few teams are going to be a little nonplussed about this, but Bill Oberlin, Maxime Martin, and that number 55 BMW crew.
Came up the hill on the outside, the left-hand side.
No doubt smiling broadly inside that helmet right now.
That's Bill Oberlin. Let's try and back out by then, excuse me.
To look at the track.
Was that Ranger? Was that the Star Wars
right
car?
Turn 8 is where that car is parked.
I have
right
no
now.
Idea, sorry.
Tom Kimber-Smith there reporting on the radio that he was had some difficulty with one of the other cars, one of the PC cars perhaps.
Well, let's see if we can pick it up, find out what happened. As right now, just watching Tom Kimber-Smith, this is that such an incredibly unpleasant moment. Yeah. Well, I was just thinking of that. Well, on board with Oberlin. Up. Whoa, wow. That's what happened with Yanni.
Wow. The two leaders there side by side, sandwiching with it, the number 55 car. Goodness gracious me. And Lucas Fuel on the outside line, and Neil Chandy tries to hang it on there, brakes too deep on the dirty side of the track, slips right off the road, kind of does an Alex Zanardi, but isn't able to prevent Lucas Fuel from going past.
Man, a piece of tar. Now, here's what may happen with Tom Kimber-Smith, and yeah, I got a little contact there. Couldn't quite pick up the car number. He said he thought it was the 18, which yes, would be Tristan Nunez.
Yeah, I think it probably was the light blue car there.
But Yanni, yeah, just dropping those lefts. Just over that curbing and the run up into the corkscrew. And, of course, the grip suddenly goes away. The car slewed sideways. And right at the end of that, I saw a little piece of something come off of that car. Hopefully it was minor. By the way, folks, if this is the first time you are watching and wondering where does this rebellion team come for in that side panel, the plate on the edge of that rear wing. You see the white cross with the red background. It's a Swiss-based team. And one that is running a double program this year here in the American Le Mans Series, presented by Tequila Patron. Also the LMP2 or the P1 category in the World Endurance Championship, where they have, obviously they're up against Audi in the factory Toyota program. They have the Privateer Trophy category, and they have been dominating in that series. Let's check in with Jamie.
I was talking to Bart Hayden, the team manager for Rebellion Racing. He was saying, yes, they are a team on the road. They're Swiss-based, but this is considered their home away from home race because of Lima, one of their sponsors. This is the home event for them. So they've really wanted to come in with it into this race strong. They have a lot of supporters out here this weekend, and that's rare for a team that's based in Europe. So they have a lot of support out here. They consider this a home one, and they're really looking to do well. But I got to tell you guys, if you were on pit lane when Lucas Lohr made that pass for the lead, you could hear Penny and Greg Pickett screaming from the top of their pit box. So a lot of excitement. There's still a lot of time left in this race, but everyone's enjoying it.
Yeah, it's also a home race for Muscle Milk Pickett Racing as well. They're based up in the Bay Area in Benicia, so that's not too far away from them. They've got a lot of supporters here as well. And boy, what a battle that has been. A tremendous pass by Lucas Lohr to wrest away the advantage from Rebellion Racing up at the corkscrew. That was a hairy pass. And wow, all credit to Lucas Lohr for hanging on to that one.
It was spectacular, and again, it was all predicated coming up on that number 55 BMW, making the choice, and he made the right one in that case, and it worked beautifully. And for the Picketts, you know, it is a family affair in that team. Greg and Penny, and of course their son Mike is very involved, and of course their daughter is married to Scott Sharp. They are racers through and through for a long, long time, and they just love this sport more than anything else. And not a surprise to hear that they were screaming with delight when that happened, of course. That's fascinating. That's absolutely fascinating. And not a surprise, though.
No.
Not a surprise at all. They love it.
Yeah, yeah, tremendously enthusiastic there. It's great to see it. You know, Greg Pickett, when he stepped out of the car at the age of 64, I think he was, a couple of years ago, he wasn't sure whether he was really going to enjoy being just a team owner. Turns out he's loving it, and so is Penny, too. Just super enthusiast, both of those two, loving every minute of running these very sophisticated cars and seeing drivers, the talent of Klaus Graf and Lucas Lohr driving their cars as well.
Yeah, well, Greg Pickett remains the only driver in history to win a Trans Am race in four separate decades. That tells you the longevity of his skill set, which is pretty remarkable. And some of my earliest memories at racetracks in the U.S. after we moved back from Europe was watching Greg Pickett in Trans Am.
So, 85 laps in the books. It's Lucas Lohr then who leads for Muscle Milk Pickett Racing in car number six over Neil Jarny in the number 12 Rebellion car. The 2P2 level 5 motorsports cars of Ryan Briscoe and Marino Franchitti, three laps down now in third and fourth place. So they're showing a lap between those two at the moment. I don't know if that's correct or not. No, it isn't. Briscoe and Franchitti both three laps down. And then the PC leader, fifth place overall, car number 9, Bruno Junqueira, still hanging on ahead of Colin Brown and Luis Diaz and Tristan Nunez. So those four cars all on the same lap in PC. Then the GT leaders, so number 3, number 17, the 91, the 56, the 48. Bryce Miller doing a fine job in the number 48 Sherpa's Watches car. He'll be handing over to Marco Holzer in the second half of this race, and that's going to be very interesting to watch, because Marco Holzer is another factory Porsche driver. And although Bryce has done a stellar job hanging on there, I fancy that Marco Holzer might be just a little bit quicker. That could be very, very interesting.
Indeed, the BMW aerial cam showing us some glorious views. We get report from Race Control. Pits open for the prototypes as we are at 1 hour and 45 minutes remaining.
And also in GT, Bill Swedler still there in sixth place, well on the lead lap, and Bill Orblin now on that lead lap in GT.
So this should be interesting to see. That's turn six, and that's a great shot of turn six, because you see that it is not a nice arcing corner. It's very angular, and that with that compression and the drop into the apex, why that corner is one of the most difficult, I think, not only at this track, but amongst many, many racetracks, because it's so crucial to carry your speed through there as well.
It is, yeah. You carry that momentum all the way up the hill toward the corkscrew. Good crowd on hand here, and the perfect racing conditions we've seen this weekend.
Phenomenal.
Under the caution for the fourth time today. I saw Jay O'Connell, who is the technical director at BMW team Ray Hall Lanigan Letterman Racing, and he was saying earlier on this afternoon that often in this race, he knows there are often caution periods as much as 20% or even 50%, somewhere between 20-50% of the whole race distance, race time,
right,
often is run under caution period. So you have to plan for these full course caution. We see the leaders want to delay.
Yeah, all of them. Lucas Lohr brings it in. Neil Johnny, Briscoe, everybody at that sharp end of things brings it in there. He hits the marks, Lohr does. And the Pickett Racing crew gets to work, Jamie.
And when that pass for the lead was made, Penny and Greg Pickett were up on the pit box screaming. Brandon Fry, the team's engineer, got on the radio and said, good job, buddy, to Lucas Lohr. Lucas radio back and said that was exciting. So this is a normal pit stop right now. Fuel going in. It looks like they are going to take tires. This was a late move. They did have a set of scrubs up on the wall, but they're going with a brand new set of stickers. These are going to take a little while to come up to temperature, but Lucas Lohr is taking the car. Justin?
Fantastic pit stop here for the 12. They spent the minimum amount of time. Remember, fans, that is the name of the game when it comes to high octane pit stops, the least time spent. Unfortunately, the Briscoe car spent a little longer. The 552 level 5 car, they actually couldn't get out from behind the 551, but they had a pretty standard stop as well. So good action down here in the pits, and I think it's normal running order as they rejoin the track.
It is that, both of those stops being done at about the same time frame, and both crews executing beautifully. Now, we're gonna, just in case you just joining us, we want to take you back and show us what happened to give us this caution, and Tom Kuemper-Smith getting a nudge.
Yeah, I mean, the PC car was clearly ahead on the inside there, and Tom Kuemper-Smith trying to hang on. And you have to kind of, there's a bit of a kink before you turn left and dive over the edge of the cliff at the corkscrew turn. And the number 18 car, I don't think really did anything wrong. They kind of moved in to take the line, and poor Tom Kuemper-Smith was kind of in the wrong place at the wrong time, I feel.
Now, this is the moment that has generated so much excitement. Watch both sides of this BMW as through they came. Johnny just a little bit too hot. Does the Zanardi bounce through the corkscrew? This time it didn't pay off, and Lucas Lohr able to make it work. Here's another angle on it, Jeremy.
Man, that was tremendous driving by Lucas Lohr. And again, he was wise enough there to see that Neil Johnny was diving down the inside. He probably couldn't see him in his peripheral vision, but he sensed that Neil wasn't going to give that up terribly easily. So he came smoking across his bows, and Lucas again gave him plenty of room to do that. Then tucked down and was able to get the much better line out of the corner. Great stuff. GT pit stop.
And yet Magnussen, who started this race, is finally getting out of the car, handing duties over to his co-driver Antonio Garcia. So it's the first driver change we've seen. Fuel still going in. No other work can be done except for that driver change until the fueling is complete. Now the car will go up on Jack's for four new Michelin tires. It's important to note the first two races of the season, the pit wall was on the opposite side of the car, so the choreography is a little bit different. In the Mazda Raceway, it was a clean stop. The three car beat the 17 from Team Falcon Tire off of pit road.
Boy, and you can see the high fives on that pit wall. That Dan Binks-led crew was just remarkable. And oh, problems, Justin.
Yeah, it was all looking absolutely standard as they came in, but they're actually changing the rear wing. Remember, the rear wing is attached to the rear window. So they are changing the rear wing for some reason. I will look into that a little bit later, but it's an integrated piece. A little protracted, but still very clean.
And it'll cost them one position. There's seven cars on the lead lap, I think, in GT. So they were running six. It only cost them one position. So if they feel there's a need to make that change on the rear wing, go ahead and do it.
Yeah.
And and get back on there, and with a minimal loss of position, I should say.
Yeah, you think maybe they had that rear wing trimmed out a little bit for some speed, but now knowing that it's going to get cooler out there, they want the grip, put a little bit more wing into it, and get that all dialed up and give that car some grip to run when it gets cooler out here. So pretty interesting to see that strategy play out. And as you said, where they were running at that time, why not take advantage of it and get that set to go as we're watching this beautiful high cam. There you can see the Delta wing. Haven't seen a lot of that car, but it has, after a long problem earlier, has been out and just putting the laps in. They often hear us talk about Mazda Raceway being technical with sweep elevations. Well, it's also physically demanding, and Evan Prelick has more.
The toll this track can take on your body is extremely demanding. You have to be physically fit to survive the G-forces. So, Pat, tell me exactly what is a G-force?
G-force is something we hear a lot in racing. It's basically a measurement of gravitational pull on the body. For us drivers, when we're out on the racetrack, we feel a lot of that on our arms, our legs, and especially our neck. And to demonstrate this, I've made you a high-tech helmet connected to a classic bowling ball. Now keep in mind, this is only 1G of simulated force, and 3 to 4 times a lap, we're feeling 3 of these pulling on our neck at any given time.
Oh my gosh, so you have to endure this back and forth around the track every single lap.
Makes for a long day at the office.
I'm glad it's you out there, not me.
Yeah, you know, you think about it in terms of the physical demands on these drivers. In the early days, the races might have been longer and a lot of things unfolding, but they weren't suffering all these G loads and the like, and they were sliding around a lot and everything. And as that downforce and the grip and all of that came into play, the physical beating these drivers take, like fighter pilots in many ways with the G loads on the cars, they have got to be absolutely as fit as can be. And Justin, you've experienced that.
Yes, I have. And you remember the days of sports car racing in the 80s and 90s when the drivers used to do Le Mans and Daytona and Sebring with just 2 drivers. And while my dad and his generation like to say that that's when men were real men, the real truth of it is, yes, they were. It was very dangerous and very physical. But the cars didn't have the corner loads. They didn't have the braking G. They overall did not have the downforce package that causes the drivers these days to suffer so much over the course of a long stint. And that's why there are 3 drivers in the cars for the long distance races.
Absolutely right, Justin Bell. And the biggest change, apart from all the safety aspects, of course, is the tyre technology. It's come on immensely, even over the last 10 years. The tyres just produce so much more grip than they did not so long ago.
Yeah, it's just everything has just improved so dramatically in terms of stick, whether it comes from the air, whether it comes from the tire, whether it comes from simply the mechanical components on the cars as chassis dynamics and the like becomes even more. Boy, look at this battle queuing up here right now. That is Jerome Bleekenbolen with that Hertz machine from JDX Racing, who has Jan Halen on board. And it is going to be interesting. That is the car that will lead them up. Again, it's any class. The first class leader behind the pace car is the one, once the wave round is completed, that will lead them away. So it's Bleekenbolen with Jan Halen right in tow, and then coming up hard astern, I believe, is Lucas Lord. He's down to the inside of Halen. And Halen just gave, there was enough room to Halen's left for a HPD prototype and a piece of paper, and Lure said that'll do. But look, the benefit that Lure gains from it, with Johnny mired behind 2 of those cars, he gets that gap.
Yeah, he does indeed. That's gonna be hard now for Johnny to make up. He's got some work ahead of him here. There is on board with the WeatherTech Porsche that is just in the lead with Jerome Bleekenbolen. And you can see just behind him is that bright, the gold-colored car of Jan Halen. There's a very small gap back to Andrew Davis, a kind of a 10 for the Dempsey Del Piero racing entry. And then the number 30 car that led so much in the early stages of this race, Nick Tandy at the wheel.
Look at this scrum coming up the hill there. That was that car you're talking about with Jan Halen. And then the rest of this pack, you've got prototype challenge cars, LMP2 cars. This is it. This is what we're talking about with multi-class sports car endurance racing. On board now with Marino Franchitti in that number 551 level 5 HPD LMP2 prototype. And he's trying to follow some of these guys through. You saw Marino take a look at his mirror and realized, I better not be turning in yet at this point. Lots of traffic gathered up around him as we're back on board with Marino right now, running 4th overall, 2nd in P2 to the team car.
That's right, Scott Tucker leads. That's right, that's Scott Tucker right ahead of us right now on board with Marino Franchitti. Marino Franchitti, of course, has taken over this car from Scott Tucker. So Scott Tucker's going to be winning whichever way he looks at it. So he's not going to be too worried if Marino Franchitti goes past him, as indeed he will fairly soon.
Oh no, wow. The number 55 limping down into the pits. And we're getting reports might be transmission problems. We also have the 23 machine, I guess, is having an issue with, I think it's a penalty for speeding. We hear the 18 that was involved with Tom Kimber-Smith might be getting a penalty for that contact, and one of the Corvettes is in, the number four of Tommy Milner. Remember, they had problems earlier. And looks like they have problems still. Yeah.
Yeah,
they're going back into that area where that gearbox is, the transaxle.
Yeah. Yeah, last year's champions and the joint championship leaders coming into this weekend. More difficulties there for that number four car. There are five laps down to the leaders in GT before this latest pit stop.
Boy, and since Lucas Lure got that opportunity and broke clear, this is about as big a lead as we've seen for a while. 3 seconds Lure has in hand over Neil Johnny in this Rebellion Lola Toyota. And it just came as a result of that great move by Lucas Lure to get to the lead in that traffic while Johnny got kind of packed up behind it. Here's the battle behind. That is Scott Tucker in the first car we see. That is an LMP Challenge car that is actually down the order just a little bit. And then you've got Marino Franchitti in the mix. And we get reports the 55 BMW behind the wall. So big problems from that car.
Yeah, that's a shame for that. There was some shuffling around in the order in GT after those pit stops. It's still the number three Corvette that leads. We saw Antonio Garcia pull out of the pit box ahead of Wolf Hensler, but now, we talked about a little while ago, it's the number 48 car. The Chopard's watch, it's Paul Miller Racing. Bryce Miller handed over that car to Marco Holzer. A great stop by those guys. They've vaulted up into third place in GT ahead of the number 56 BMW of John Edwards and Mark Goossens, who's taken over the number 91 car from Dominic Farnbacher.
And we see the 55 Crown Plaza BMW going behind the wall. Jamie, what's the word?
Well, that will be a terminal going behind the wall. Their day is done when Maxime Martin got out of the car. It seems to be transmission failure is the early diagnosis. But up pit lane, the number four car still on pit road was seemingly to still have the same gearbox issue. Let's talk big picture. Those two cars were leading the GT Championship. They were tied with the lead coming into this race, both of them now having problems. So it's anyone's game in GT so far this season. We'll see what happens when these bonus points are handed out at the end of the race.
Boy, that's a very good point Jamie brings up. Since this is a longer duration event, there is a couple of extra bonus points that are paid. And we've seen championships settled by that or less over the course of a long season of racing. So anytime you have the goose egg there in the finish column and getting points, it's huge.
It is, and it's 20 points, 22 points with those two extra points for the 4-hour race. 22 points therefore up to grabs for the winner of each of the classes this evening.
There
Justin
is
Nunez also serving that penalty.
Yeah.
Kind of a 18. It was a little bit harsh, quite frankly, but he's serving a 67-second stop and hold penalty for that contact with the 06 car at the top of the corkscrew. And we could see from the contact on when we're on board with Tom Kipper-Smith that the front of his car made contact with the rear of the PC car, but the PC car was presumably adjudged to have moved over unnecessarily. Let's have a look on board here with the Porsche going up the hill. A bit harsh, but there wasn't a full car width on the right-hand side of the road from the perspective of Tristan Nunez in car number 18.
Well, that's one of the things. Tristan Nunez's first season running in the LMP Challenge in the American Le Mans Series, a wickedly quick driver, a champion in the Prototype Lights Development Series. One of the things you learn with this multi-class racing is just because the car you're going by disappears from your peripheral view, there's still a rear deck that you need to clear, and that's one of those things that you learn. And you know, it's tough sometimes to have a spotter sitting here, as they're not able to tell you that okay, you're clear, you're clear. So it's just something that you tend to learn. And I mean, there's been races over the years. I remember at Lime Rock, went to Capello, and one of the Audis had a huge lead, came up, was working some traffic, and did that exact same thing, and took himself out of it. It happens.
Yeah.
Is that so Marino going to the lead?
The second time in two races there for number 18 car penalty is probably going to cost them a chance to win the race. He's lost a lap now to the leaders in BC. Look at this, there's a battle going on right here. It's Colin Brown who leads by about 7 seconds over the battle that was just coming down the hill between Luis Diaz and Bruno Junqueira. I think Bruno Junqueira made a pit stop during this latest caution period, and I don't believe the other leaders in PC did. That's why I think he went from first in the class to fourth in the class. But now he's putting pressure again on Luis Diaz after the penalty for Nunez. that pattern now for second and third in PC.
And you called it. You talked about Marco Holzer getting behind the wheel of the 48 Chopard Watches car, and he is hounding Wolf Hensler right now in that battle for second in GT. An absolutely incredible day so far for that number three CompuWare Corvette team. Now Antonio Garcia behind the wheel. There is Hensler in second. Again, that blue and teal car, the number 17 from Falcon Tires, and right behind him is Marco Holzer, and not too far back of them continues to run John Edwards, now behind the wheel of the number 56. Joey Hand would be the normal driver in that car, but Joey busy right now over in Europe, and as a result, they've asked John Edwards, who ran with the team in Sebring, and acquitted himself rather smartly.
I think Joey actually is back in Sacramento, not too far from here this weekend. They've given him a weekend off. He had a very busy weekend last year in the DTM, a great run to seventh place, his best career finish, despite stalling at the start of the race. It's a great run. And he's going to get it ready for another race very shortly in Europe as well. And that is his primary focus this season. Wow.
And Scott Tucker.
That was close. He pulled off trying to rejoin the racetrack, doing a new turn right in front of somebody else.
Hey, you're good. You're good.
Damage to the left rear corner.
Okay.
Yeah.
Or that 552 car.
Oh, there. The car's okay. Stay out.
Well, you hear the crew saying the car looks okay, stay out, and then they'll move over by that wall a little bit. Well, not too close. The crew, I thought they might want to have a good look at it as he comes by. And he just radioed that he thought there was contact, and he thought it may have been Luis Diaz in the 52. And that's what was radioed from Tucker to the crew. Let's take a look at it.
552 coming down the hill. Yeah, there was another car there to the left-hand side.
Mm-hmm. Ooh, and then he got clipped again.
Yeah, I think that was probably by Bruno Junqueira. The second of the cars going past. That was a battle for second and third. Here they are there, and you can see Tucker just squeezes across onto Diaz, and Diaz jumps over the curb on the inside. There is a contact indeed with Bruno Junqueira. So second and third place cars in PC. It's going down the hill through. The P2 car should be a good bit quicker than the PC cars, but not the case on that occasion.
Yeah, and I think you're right. I think
Diaz was under intense pressure from Junqueira. He didn't want to lose that time, so he kind of stuck his nose in there, and it got chopped off.
Now the question is, we got three cars that had a little contact there. It looked like Diaz probably got the best of it. This car has some damage, but the question is Bruno Junqueira's car, because that was you can hear it audibly, that was a serious thump. And bodywork loosened up on Junqueira's car at the very least. And riding along here with Tucker. And there goes Lucas Luhr down the inside. Checking in with GT in this battle for second continues. There's Antonio Garcia. And that number three Corvette, it just seems to be able to just eke away when it's on clear track.
At least for now, but you can see that the battle amongst the Porsches there for second and third, but the race leader, Lucas Luhr, he's coming through between that battle, but right there also is the remaining BMW. John Edwards really doing a fine job, just his second run in that car. Ran with the team at Sebring, did not run at Long Beach. He was running elsewhere at the Road Atlanta, winning actually in the Rolex GT class, but again doing a fine job for Bobby Rahal in this number 56 BMW.
Johnny is going to be furious. He had to run up the hill, and right in front of him suddenly Holzer moved over, thinking about trying to make a move on Wolf Hensler. They were side by side up the hill, and Johnny just had to stop and follow all the way through the corkscrew, and that cost him a huge amount of time. Last time it was 1.6 seconds. Let's see what it is this time. This will give you an idea. 2.5 seconds it's ballooned up to.
Yeah, and he's not had much luck with the traffic in the last few laps, has he?
No.
Neil Gianni, but before that, we saw that Lucas Luhr wasn't having much luck. So once again, the swings and roundabouts of sports car racing is very much in evidence here as the P1 leaders fight their way through the traffic.
And when that traffic is...
It's a lot of the mental side of the sport. It's really, really important, keeping it cool in those sort of situations.
Well, and the thing is, when that traffic is incredibly close racing in the GT category, I mean, these guys they're pros, and if they can let you through and not cost them anything, they'll certainly
do it.
But they're not just going to open the door and lose a bunch to the guy that they're racing. They're in this to win in their class as well, and they're amongst the best in the world. They're just driving a different category of car, and it could be really interesting, as we have seen. Back on board with Tucker here. Second in P2, even with that shunt, because of the problems with the Tequila Patron HPD cars. He's coming up on that battle. That is Edwards right in front of him, fourth in GT. Boy, there's nothing between those three cars, second, third, and fourth.
John Edwards, he's 22 years old now. And when he started racing, he was picked up by Red Bull, and as a 14-year-old, he became the youngest driver ever to earn an FIA license in Europe. He was way too young, in my opinion, but they dropped him a few years later after coming back over here racing Atlantics, I thought, pretty impressively.
Yeah.
I think he was dropped at the age of 16, when most kids are just starting out. And then after that, he came back in the Star Mazda, now Pro Mazda Championship. He missed the first race of the season, did a deal to do race two of the championship, won it. That was at Miller Motorsports Park, and then managed to do a deal to run the whole rest of the season with the A Motorsport team. Won the championship, won a scholarship from Mazda to move up into Atlantic, won there as well.
Yeah.
And then they got the opportunity to move into Rolex GT Racing, and he's made his home in GT Racing ever since. But he's a great story, as John Edwards, and he's a heck of a driver.
He truly is, and a nice man.
Class act.
Interviewed him a couple of times doing work for Speed in the pits for Grand Am Racing, where he runs. And a couple of times, you know, things happen with TV every once in a while. You're all set up for something, and then something happens, and everything's put on pause. And he has patiently waited for a long time, a couple of times, and just a smile, oh, hey, it happens, we get it, no worries. Just a great guy, but you put that helmet on him, he is fast, and right now running fourth in GT. There's the Corvette leading, just going out of frame. There is the Falcon Tire Porsche, the Chopard Watch Porsche, and the Crown Plaza BMW having a very, very strong run here. And Mark Goossens sits in fifth, and he's closing. Yeah, he is coming up and making this one. This is going to be a good four-car battle here at this point. So looking forward to it, and it's going to be a lot of fun. We're going to step away for just a moment. There are your class leaders. Once again, this is Mother's Day weekend, so a lot of the teams and drivers, well, they wanted to say hello.
Happy Mother's Day to all the mothers out there, especially my mom Marina, I love you. And my wife Holly, new mother this year, happy Mother's Day to you. But in the UK, it was Mother's Day in March, so I've already done it, so I'm ahead of the game.
I want to wish my mother a happy Mother's Day and my wife as well, and I'll see you soon.
Rated E for everyone.
We dream of speed, of pushing to the limit and beyond. We dream of racing the ghosts of history, of perfect passes and podium finishes. We dream to compete. We dream to win.
Xbox 360, starting at $99.
Now relax. Let the chi flow from the inner Zhang Fu organs outwards as the needles open your meridians.
Oh, it feels so good. I really thought the needles would hurt.
So did I. I hate needles.
That must make it hard to do what you do.
Oh, not really. I deliver paninis. He's the acupuncturist. But I did stay at a Holiday Inn Express last night.
Oh.
Stay smart. Stay at a Holiday Inn Express.
This isn't just a car. It's a legend. This isn't just a family. It's a statement. And this isn't just a brand. It's an attitude. This is SRT. Street and Racing Technology.
Doc? Doc? Goose!
Oh.
Our technology builds some of the best tires in the world. Because when it comes to performance, we don't just play around.
Cheater, we said no 360s.
Who's up for some leapfrog?
Welcome back, and we are under a full course caution here at Mazda Raceway, Laguna Seca. But once again, folks, want to remind you about the opportunity the American Le Mans Series and Chevrolet have come up with. They've teamed up for a sports car racing fan's dream, a grand prize of the all-new 2014 Chevrolet Corvette Stingray and an all-expense-paid VIP insider trip to none other than the 24 Hours of Le Mans. Go to racetowincorvette.com for your chance to win the ultimate sports car fan's dream prize. racetowincorvette.com, and you could own one, and you could be watching them race at La Sarthe. Boy, how cool would that be as we are under caution? As I mentioned, Lucas Lure is leading, and there is why the number 45 Flying Lizards Porsche. It looks like the turn three exit area, but boy, that's something you'd think happened going into that corner where that car ended up. At this point, but they're going to be able to extract it, pull it right out.
It's three cautions caused by the lizards, isn't it?
Yeah, they've had a tough day as well. So let's see if we can come up with what happened. Again, our great camera and video crew looking through the footage. Here we go, way in the background. Well, there you
around
see
she goes.
Yeah. Almost looks like it got away from him going into the turn, like I said, right there. So yes, there was some other traffic around, but it didn't look, at least from that perspective, if there was a problem.
Nelson Canache here having an off there. So yeah, they've both been in the, both he and Seth Nyman have been in the gravel today. I don't think Spencer Pompelli has. So hopefully they can keep it to just the two of them going off into the gravel.
Well, you can see Porsche can serve as a nice earth mover as well when it goes in and then is extracted out and just packs all that gravel up underneath there. And that makes for a very sketchy track surface, hard on tires as well as just grip.
Yeah, good news here for both Dempsey Del Piero racing entries. They're now the number 27 car is back on the lead lap. Also Andrew Davis in the number 10 car. So we've got now five cars on the lead lap in GTC for when we go back to green. Led by number 22, Jerome Blakemolen, number 30, Nick Tandy, number 11, Jan Halen, number 27, Andy Lally, and number 10 of Andrew Davis. I believe Damien Faulkner in the first of the two TRG cars is still a lap down in car number 66. There is Andy Lally, and he's been quick again this weekend. This team made its debut with the GTC in the GTC class at Sebring. Andy Lally amazingly put the car on pole position. Stellar effort by Andy Lally, a very versatile, very accomplished driver, and he has been fast all weekend long here as well, mixing it with the best of the European Porsche stalwarts.
Yeah, he's shown an ability to do that, hasn't he? We've seen what he's done in the Rolex 24 at Daytona, where he's done some incredible stuff. Oh, look at this, a little research of the 2013 rules package. I bet they're looking up under the heading emergency service. Yes or no?
Yes. Yeah, good news and bad news for Corvette racing today. The number four car having a difficulty, but number three car still running strong out in front. Antonio Garcia having taken over from Jan Magnussen. A great battle still going on there. Garcia, Hensler, Holzer, Edwards, Goosen, Swedler, all on the lead lap. Top six cars still on the lead lap in the GT class. Tom Kimber-Smith, after that incident earlier on, a couple of laps behind in seventh place, along with the 62 Ferrari, Luigi Capistrano Ferrari, Olivia Beretta. They've had all sorts of penalties. They also two laps down.
Yeah, penalties, and then also just kind of got punted off into the gravel as well. So they've just had everything has happened to them today. It's been unbelievable. You saw from the BMW aerial cam that the wave around has commenced. Ooh, piece of junk on the track that cars coming up. All able to see at least. Hopefully we'll be able to get somebody out there and get that removed. Get back to going as we are closing in. Well, we're just under now, an hour and 15 minutes remaining in this third round of the American Le Mans Series, presented by Tequila Patron, the American Le Mans Monterey. Beautiful out still. Taking money on when that marine layer comes in.
Well, hopefully not until after we're done with the race. The temperature will drop dramatically, right? That's been a beautiful day here.
Yeah, sure, But noticeably warmer than it's been at any other point during this weekend.
Yeah.
And that was a big focal point earlier in the day with people going, boy, what are we going to do?
We should adjust and leave it in the hotel so we can see the marine layer over there. That's looking up towards Santa Cruz across the Monterey Bay. And staying in Carmel, which is just kind of the other side of that, and leaving the hotel this morning, it was actually clear. But then coming up over into Monterey and along the Carmel, Salinas Valley towards the racetrack, it was thick marine layer just like that, all the way until literally just driving into the racetrack, and it's been clear here all day long.
It's beautiful when you see it working its way through the hills and everything, unless you need to be racing in it. Then not so nice. And the effect that it has on the weather, and therefore all of the equations that the engineers have formulated in terms of tires and grip and all of that. And that's the key. The engineers, they're the ones that have to come up with a solution. And we continue. Looks like pace car is going to stay out at least one more lap.
Yeah, I've been here several times in the past where the morning fog has delayed the proceedings quite substantially. So. Again, that's not been a factor there. I don't think it'll be a factor this evening in terms of delaying anything or interrupting anything. It's going to be terribly pleasant if it comes in. But the condition's still absolutely perfect right now. Pits have not yet been opened, I don't think, have they?
No, nobody has gone, at least. So, well, there we go. Yeah, our crew is amazing. Look at this. Here we go. Hour one, the temperature. This is on track. The actual track temperature itself, 102.2. Hour two, 100.4. Hour three. So it is dropping just a little bit. That's just because the sun, the angle is getting a little bit lower in the sky, and it's not just beating directly down quite so far.
Yeah, it's off to 6:15 now in the evening. It'll still be light by the time we finish this race. We have raced into the dark in the past. I don't think it'll be dark here before the checker flag comes out, but it'll certainly be significantly cooler than it was earlier in the day. And you know, as you say, we talk about the strategies, and most of these teams in the pro classes certainly have different tire compounds to choose from, and they'll be able to run softer tires perhaps into the evening than they would have been during the day.
Well, we're in a nice cozy booth, and right down in the mix on that tarmac is Jamie.
Well, pit lane has just opened, but our friends at Michelin, they just gave me an updated temperature. It's 86 degrees Fahrenheit now out on the track surface. That's 30 degrees Celsius. Sure, we'll have to keep an eye on it.
Yeah, absolutely. It's going to be interesting. We get word now, pits are open for prototypes. And with an hour and 11, I don't think you can make it with just one more stop at this point.
No, it's going to be very close. The prototypes could do about 55 minutes probably at the most on a green flag run, and even making a pit stop now, it'll be another probably best part of 10 minutes before we go back to green. So that'll leave it just over an hour, or around about an hour, to go to the end of the race. So it'll be tight, and they will be able to save some fuel, and perhaps if there is another full course caution, then they might be able to reach the finish. So all conjecture at this stage, but we will for sure see pretty much everybody onto pit lane now. And I think there's no doubt that the GT cars can make their final pit stops on the next lap. The pits are open now for prototypes, next lap for GT cars. And when the GT cars come in and take on fuel, they should just about be able to get to the end of this race without making an additional pit stop.
I think that'll be close, but I think, from the numbers that we've been hearing, and certainly the GT Challenge cars, anybody that stops on that happens there should be absolutely good to go. So here comes Bruno Junqueira, and interesting to see what, if any, reaction they're going to do to that left rear corner of that car. That's where he clocked Tucker's LMP2 car when they had that contact. Bruno, not any cause of it, obviously, was just trying to avoid him. And they're not paying a lot of attention to it at this point. They're just doing a tire change, so apparently they've looked at it. and assess that it's okay, and they're going to send him back out. There is the car leading in the LMP Challenge Bicontinental Class, the 05 Core Autosport entry. Colin Brown behind the wheel. They've just you can see a little bit of clag and debris on the front of the car, but otherwise it's looking pretty clean, Justin.
Yes, it is. The car is actually in immaculate shape. There's a little bit of rubber on the bodywork, as you'd expect from pickup being thrown off other cars. And as Colin drives out, that was the perfect stop for these guys. As we've been talking about all weekend, it's a really early in the development for this team, and they are showing that they will be, and are right now, a force to be reckoned with.
Yeah, to be sure, with that GT program so new, and to be able to come in with that new program and be able to put that Pete Challenge car on pole. They've been very strong in that category for a couple of years, and to maintain that level of excellence when they're debuting this other program, well done.
Yeah, it looked like a longer stop there for RSR Racing, and Bruno Ginchera now finally getting underway. I thought I saw also, as the Core Autosport car was leaving the pit lane, the number 18, the Performance Tech Motorsports car of Tristan Nunez, went past, I think, before him. So if he's able to do that, conceivably that number 18 car could get the wave by before we go back to green and get back onto the tail end of the lead lap in PC.
Well, yeah, it was Brown, Luis Diaz in the number 52, Junquera the number 9, Marcelli the number 8, and Rusty Mitchell in the number 7, your top 5 in the LMP Challenge by Continental Class. And I wonder if that little bit longer start by Junquera is if they did attend to something on that left rear corner, just to attach something, reattach something, put that high speed tape on it. That was as close as it gets. These guys trying to come in, and at an hour 7 plus, oh boy, this is going to be close to getting them to the end. But they are all coming in, rolling the dice, and Jan Magnussen had handed over to Antonio Garcia, who brings it in. Justin.
Yes, there is. You should have seen the sense of anticipation on every member of this Corvette team as they came up. As you just said, this is a most significant pit stop of the race, perhaps, because they can run for the finish from here. Even if there's another yellow, it just adds a little bit of safety buffer. They're changing the Michelins, they are going, the fuel is ready to go, and they're keeping Garcia in the car. It's a very tidy stop, and Corvette, as you know, are masters at this, and off they go. Fantastic. High fives all around. That's the way to do a pit stop, guys.
Great stop by the Falcon team too. They were moving sooner even. That was great. Of course, they had stopped a little bit sooner as well.
Looks like the BMW there might have gone up into third place there. John Edwards just looming over the top of the crest. There is the GTC leading WeatherTech car of Jeroen Blakemolen on pit lane. Andrew Davis, I think, didn't make a pit stop. He might have stopped under the previous caution, however. So yeah, there's a lot of strategy be playing out here. I'm sure those that needed to stop obviously would have come in now, and maybe the ones that didn't come in didn't need to stop. So that's going to be quite a battle, because I think the number 10 and the number 66, which is now back on the lead lap, Damien Faulkner, are going to be leading GTC when we go back to green. Boy, that's going to be a battle.
Oh, isn't it? Can't wait for that one. And same story. You take a look at what's unfolding in the LMP Challenge class. With Colin Brown, Diaz, Junquera, Marcelli, Mitchell are going to be close. GT, well, that's just off the charts. And what we've been seeing from Lure and Johnny, you would think this one is just going to be fraught as well. And then the two team cars leading in LMP2, the 551 level 5 entry and the 552. Franchitti and Tucker, respectively. Tucker, of course, that car we know is a little bit damaged. What a day. And there is a whip. Pat Long now back behind the wheel of the Core Autosport Porsche.
Yeah, I don't think the overall leaders came into the pit lane, did they? The 6-12, and that's I think going to be bad news for the Tristan Nunez car, because although he got out ahead of the other guys in the PC class, because the overall leaders didn't come in, the overall leaders will be behind the safety car when we get ready for the restart. So it will be they that lead the race. So Tristan Nunez will be back on the same lap as the other contenders in PC, but he'll be just ahead of them on the road, not at the at the back of the train.
Nick Tandy on board the Momo machine, running third in class right now.
the reason that number 6 and number 12 quit to come on the pit lanes because they knew they couldn't get to the end of the race without making another pit stop from here. But
right. Yeah, this is good. Anticipating going green this time by. This is going to be furious. Watch for the lights to go out on that safety car. Interesting to see the different approaches. Johnny just swerving back and forth trying to get heat and clean those tires that way. And Lucas Lure doing burnouts and then hard brake. Burnouts and hard brakes to clean the rears off the car. It's interesting to see how it unfolds as we sit on board the Corvette. Again, kind of doing the same thing. Just trying to get that junk off those rears. And the best way to do that, light them up.
Yeah. Boy, this is going to be a battle. So it's Garcia, Sellers, Edwards, Lucas, Holzer, and Bell. Number 3, 17, 56, 91, 48, and 23. That's going to be the six-car battle. Pretty much nose to tail in GT, where we go back to green in PC. 0, 5, 52, 9, and 8. The top four in PC.
Right before that four-course caution, the number 55 BMW, Bill Oberlin and Maxime Martin, they came in for their pit stop, but it was not on schedule. It was transmission failure. They've gone back behind the wall. And we've also had pit stops from the number 3, the number 4. So lots of actions on pit lane. It's all shuffled back out, but we are back to green flag racing.
We are indeed, and there Lucas Lure leading down to the Andretti hairpin. Neil Johnny right with him, and this time no traffic, nobody to complicate matters. This is it, mano a mano, team on team. This should be fun to see who's got the upper hand at this stage.
Yeah, straight off battle now for the end of the race, perhaps, between these two. And certainly, advantage here to Lucas Lure, a great jump at the restart, able to put on a small margin over Neil Johnny, but this is going to be a tremendous battle. So far through the weekend, the Rebellion car, car number 12, the black and gold and red car, the closed-top Mola sports car, has been a little bit quicker than the HPD of Lucas Lure. But we're going to have to see what's happened in the final hour of the race. It could be a completely different story.
Oh, and I'll tell you, one of the players in this GT ranks, if we get the word right, Marco Holzer, maybe being brought in for a penalty for a pit speed violation. Oh, very close there. A couple of the challenge class cars, one a prototype, one the GT, having a bit of a moment there in the corkscrew. Everybody getting through clean. The number 30 Momo car reported that they're going to be brought in for a stop and hold for 20 for a problem as well. See, look at that, three abreast, heading right down at the apex of turn 10. As this great GT battle, and it was like, it looked like Edwards was going to be able to make the move, and then Wolf Hensler, who had Edwards swoop the outside, tried to come right back down the inside and couldn't get it done. Wow, what a great launch and great lap by John Edwards up to second.
Yeah, he's been not a revelation because we know he's a very talented driver. Ferrari, recent competition, I mean, Ferrari going to the back down there of the 06 Porsche. A little bit of contact, but both cars able to continue unscathed.
Watch this move here on board with Edwards. Hensler got trapped. Edwards just drives the outside of Rainy Curve, sets him up for the inside, three abreast at the apex of 10, and Edwards survived.
Wow, that was pretty brave.
And now there's a little contact there. Hensler being a bit defensive, trying to keep Mark Goossens behind him in the Viper. That was fierce.
It was, Michaels. That's what I expected when we get back to green here. But a great restart by John Edwards. You know, he's on a roll. He's won the last two races in the Rolex GT Series. Drives for Stevenson Motorsports. And now he's trying to get his first win for the MW as well. He always dust off the edge of the turn. Somebody off the road on the right-hand side, I think.
Yeah, and we just saw Olivia Beretta just grinding by the side of the Core Autosport car after taking him down in the Andretti hairpin. Just peeled some paint off him as they got down into the apex at the corkscrew. So Beretta, he wants through, and he wants through in a hurry. And right now, Goossens going by one of the Tully's Coffee, Dempsey Del Piero GTC cars, and Townsend Bell down with a nice move as well.
Yeah, that car is right there in contention as well. Townsend Bell right now in fifth place in the class with that penalty for Marco Holzer, a costly penalty for Paul Miller Racing.
Yeah, Goose is just off track at the exit of the entry. Here we go with caution. We are full course caution. And there is the number 7 Epic entry, one of our LMP Challenge cars, and it's Brian Sellers actually back on board, and from Wolf Hensler. So, boy, what an eventful day here. That number 7 machine, Tommy Dreese, Rusty Mitchell, the Bar One Motorsports car, and boy, they got a little help. That looked like Colin Brown.
It did.
Taking him into that move.
Yeah, yeah, and that's going to be interesting. I'm sure race control will be looking at that,
Greg,
because there's no doubt there was contact from the front of the 05 onto the rear of the number 7 car. The number 7 car was of Rusty Mitchell, was a lap down in PC, but that's no excuse. That's going to be very interesting. Wow.
And huge implications.
It does. I mean,
they have dominated this weekend. Absolutely has that core Autosport 05 car pole leading comfortably, and that could all be changing.
The guy we're looking at right now, number 52 car, Luis Diaz. That car already has a win at Sebring, second place at Long Beach, and it's currently running in second place now as we await word from race control as to whether there's going to be any penalty for the 05 car.
Yeah, man. Amazing. Well, look at the view up here in this area of the country, the Monterey Peninsula and the Salinas Valley, as you talk about. By the way, the 11, which has been a car that's been a player in the GT Challenge category with the JDX Hertz entry of Jan Halen, looking, there's a potential penalty there as well, we're being told. So we'll see how that all plays out. Wow.
Boy, race control has been busy today.
Yeah, they're getting their hands dirty and going for it. That's for sure.
Yeah.
So we're going to do this all over again as we're now under an hour. Under an hour. 57 and a half minutes remaining. So we're going to go up, I think, with a slightly different angle on the incident that caused this car, Rusty Mitchell, to end up in the gravel. Right here, this is our speed shot. See what happens.
Colin Brown looking to the inside of the left-hander. And he runs over the curb on the inside, trying to make sure he doesn't make contact with the number 7. But contact was indeed made coming off the corner. And Rusty Mitchell spins away to the outside, soars the car, gets stuck in the gravel.
Yep.
And that brings out our fourth course caution.
Sort of similar to the Tucker Molecule Diaz incident. And they said they went no harm, no foul on that one. But I think Diaz was a little closer up along the inside.
Huh. Yeah, and they were two different classes as well.
Right.
These cars have got the same sort of performance. Rusty Mitchell has been doing a nice job in this car. Another former single-seater driver from Texas. Spent a lot of time in the Pro Mazda Championship, and that's where he picked up most of experience. But really enjoying his time here in the sports cars, driving with that Bar One Motorsports team. They've had some misfortunes today, but amazing, actually. Carl Marcelli in number 8 car has got himself back onto the lead lap in the car number 8. So in PC we have the 05, the 52, the 9 and the number 8 car, all those four still on the same lap as each other. And then Carl Marcelli, then Tristan Nunez showed us one lap down in car number 18. Another penalty a while ago.
And of course, the GT, the number 3 Corvette of Garcia, the 56 BMW of Edwards, the 17 Falcon Tire Porsche, now with Brian Sellers behind the wheel, the 23 Team West AJR Ferrari of Townsend Bell, and the number 91, that is the Fast and Furious 6 SRT Viper of Mark Goossens, all shown on the same lap.
Board there with Mark Goossens. And in GTC, we're showing the number 10 car, Andrew Davis. He's come up very nicely indeed. Damien Faulkner, too, has been nowhere all weekend in the number 66 TRG car, but he's right there in second place now, and it would be hard to dislodge from that. Andy Lally in third place in number 27. Jerome Blakemolen, who's led a goodly portion of the race along with Cooper McNeil in number 22 car, in fourth place. And all still also on the lead lap, number 11 of Jan Halen, and the number 30 of Nick Tandy.
I'm just wondering, though, because at the last stop, when Bleekemolen certainly pitted, I don't know that Davis, Faulkner, or Lally did.
They didn't.
So that's going to be a stretch on fuel from when they had pitted to see if they could make it to the end. This isn't going to hurt them, this long caution, that's for sure.
I fancy those guys pitted under the previous caution, which wasn't that long ago, and this caution certainly will help them get to the end of this race without needing extra service.
Exactly.
We talked about it early on, didn't we? Yeah. Strategy. When you make your pit stops, you know, we knew there were going to be a lot of caution periods here. You talked about that at the very top of the show. That's exactly what it turned out to be. Six caution periods here. Rather too much of the race run under caution, I have to say. But it'll still be some fabulous racing when we are under green flag conditions.
Yeah, so it's going to be interesting to see. Remember, we were looking at that in terms of some of the GT cars when they pitted. How close were they? This caution, I think, will put them into a little bit more of a comfort zone in getting them to the end. The question now, though, is some of the prototype cars, certainly the LMP1, LMP2 entries, are they going to need now to make one more stop? And are they going to do it when the pits open for prototypes here, get their splash and get ready to go? And talk about pressure in a pit stop.
Yes.
On board the number 30 with Nick Tandy, the Mobile AGT Motorsport team. Currently sitting sixth in class. And again, the report was they had to do a stop plus a stop plus 20. So this caution is exactly what they needed to get back up. And word from race control, pits open, all cars.
Yeah, because it's less than 15 minutes since the previous caution period, so we call this a kind of a quickie yellow. Because not everybody will be needing service, then it won't be too crazy. Shouldn't be too crowded on pit lane. And so anybody who needs to come in now can do it on this lap around them. That'll save us a lap before we get back to green flag racing.
Wow, just got a radio call that the number 6 of Lure will pit.
Sure.
Yep.
Yeah, they both
they
need
have
to pit.
To.
Both
yeah,
need
exactly.
To pit.
Yep.
Yep. The question now is, do they take on tires?
Yeah.
And and how quick the guys can complete their service.
This is when you are given very clear evidence, folks, that this is a team sport.
Yes.
We're giving it a full service.
In the hands of the crews. And you heard the call, full service. It's up to these crews. Boy, that slow pit speed seems interminable. You've been running at race speeds. This is interesting. Let's check in with Jamie.
Lucas Lohr saying in the car he's getting a fresh drink bottle. They
I
don't have
the tires
drink
out of the way.
Bottle in the car, so whenever they come in for a pit stop, the team throws him a bottle. It is a timed fuel stop. I'm not sure if they're going to take tires. The number 12 car beating him out of pit road. So clearly, that was a timed only. There's a timed fuel pit stop for Rebellion. They just need as much fuel.
Down to you.
What happened with the 12? Remember, this is a direct gunfight between these two. They did not come in on the last yellow, so they were waiting for this opportunity. They would have had to pit under green. They needed this stop, but that was a smart move. No tires, just fuel. Out they went. I reckon that was Rebellion flexing their very good race strategy muscle again.
Well, it's an interesting ploy, isn't it? Because at Long Beach, it was the picket team that played the strategy role to perfection, and the Rebellion team, Neil Janney, said, we learned a lesson here because this is new to us, and they showed us a lesson here. So they've tried it. The interesting thing is, what's going to happen with tires if it's cooling off? Did the picket boys come up with a little different pressure setting on the cars to be better? This is going to be fascinating, Jeremy.
Well, did they actually change tires on the picket car at the end there? I'm not sure. They were certainly ready to.
Right.
We didn't actually, I don't think we quite saw whether or not they did change the tires. I think perhaps when they saw that the Rebellion car didn't change tires, maybe they changed the strategy, or maybe they were just trying to, you know, lull the Rebellion cars into thinking they were going to change tires. I don't know which way that could be. It could have gone either way. But I don't believe that the number six guys did change tyres on that number six car ultimately. So, but it was a great stop, certainly, by Rebellion Racing.
Yeah.
Maybe they needed, obviously, they needed a little bit less fuel than did the number six car, and that has got them now the track position. So, wow, tremendous work there on the pit lane. And once again, you talked about the fuel one away. It's a team sport, and that was great teamwork by Rebellion Racing.
Well, and you're absolutely right. The other side of the coin is if you do a full tire change, on this track, it takes a while for those tires to come up to temp. So 2, 3, 4 laps where you're not as quick and that guy gets away. Boy, this is going to be just fascinating to watch it unfold. So this is going to be interesting. Yeah, oh, it is indeed in all the classes.
We've got a class leader at the front of the field behind the safety car, so there's not going to be any more shuffling of positions here. We'll be able to go back to green hopefully next time around. I'm pretty sure it's Colin Brown there leading the field behind the safety car, the Mazda 6 safety car.
Let's take a look at where our Michelin Green X Challenge stands at this time. In the prototype class, it would be Rebellion Racing. You take a look at that fuel or that clean, fast, efficient formula and the total. And right now, they're up over the Muscle Milk Picket Racing entry and the Level 5 Motorsports number 552. So they, at this point, now there's still race time to go, 48 plus minutes remaining in this third round of the championship. In the Grand Touring division, it's the number 23 Team West, Alex Job Racing. But look how close those numbers are, folks. Incredibly close with the number 3 Corvette sitting in second. And again, this is a very prestigious championship within a championship, if you will, that these teams are very proud of. When you go faster than anybody else, farther than anybody else, and yet you do it cleaner than anybody else, and that comes out, that says an awful lot about the efficiency of your program as a whole, and it means a lot. So let's go back and take a look at a review at these pit stops. And it was pretty fierce and fast. And there's the look at it. And we're going to go back and listen to the call that Jamie made because it was fascinating. And take a look at it right here. Oh, boy. Now, they've got the tires laid out, Jeremy. You're right. Let's watch.
Yep, fuel okay. goes in. Yep. It'll be a timed fuel pit stop. They think they don't need a completely full tank of fuel, but look at that, the Rebellion car is already underway and they hadn't yet finished the refueling on the number six car. There goes the number six car. There's no way there was enough time in there to change those tires. So I think I don't know whether the number six team was just trying to outfox the Rebellion guys and trick them into thinking they were changing tires, or whether they were planning on changing tires. It's certainly, we heard the pit call as they came into pit lane that it was full service, but that could have been just a bit of gamesmanship. But we are back to green flag racing.
We are indeed, and the class leader this time was Colin Brown in that 05 Core Autosport entry, and it is Luis Diaz in the 52 Molecule Machine, and then Bruno Junqueira in the number 9 Johnson Controls RSR entry. And then that GT battle. There's Antonio Garcia, Brian Sellers, Edwards. And what a great stop for the number 23 Team West, Alex Job Racing. Ferrari to find that car up into fourth in front of the 91 Viper of Goossens. And this is just, that was a remarkable stop by that Team West AJR crew. Now, question is, once everything gets back, tires are warmed up, who's got one in hand here? Boy, Goossens, he's got Pat Long hunting. Now they're down a lap, and oh, it looks like
battle for the lead,
and it's gone back to Lucas Lauren. Once again, he does it somehow, coming up into the corkscrew. But traffic, Lauren now able to get by. Johnny goes down underneath with him. Now, Lauren just stays left. If he didn't, it was over. Johnny was going to come through, and Lure reading that traffic. Now, oh man, I'll tell you, Lucas Lure on these restarts and up into the course was fantastic.
Isn't it interesting? I mean, 3 weeks ago at Long Beach, Lucas Lure was he got out of the car just 15 minutes into the race. He had to hand it over to Klaus Graf to finish it off. That strategic call won the race effectively for Muscle Milk Picket Racing. This time around, though, Lucas Lure, boy, is he getting his own back. He's done a fantastic drive. Two brilliant passes up at the corkscrew. And once again, it's the Muscle Milk Picket Racing car, car number six, that has the advantage. But for how long?
Oh, boy. Johnny
great
getting
race.
Great run into five, and Lure getting boxed behind the Corvette. Now swings out. And Johnny just not able to do anything with it at this point. Through six up the hill. There's the Delta Wing up in front of these two cars. Big blue flag flying. Lure knifes by, as does Johnny.
It's good to see the Delta Wing back out there, by the way. It's a lot of laps down, but it's certainly completing the 88 laps. So since those early delays, it seems to be running fairly nicely, which is good news for Catherine Legg and Andy Merrick to get some time into that car. But here is the battle for the lead overall, and in P1, Lucas Neal just ahead of Neal Johnny, but not by very much.
Andy Merrick doing a brilliant job of letting both those cars get through without any issues in a pretty tricky spot of the track. Nicely done. Lured down into Andretti hairpin. Ooh, Johnny a little bit wide in, but just changed the angle of that second apex. He's right there, and there is a group of challenge cars right in front of him that they are coming up on, and they're going to catch these guys heading up into six.
Great stuff. Tremendous battles in pretty much all the classes, actually, even in P2. It's Marino ahead, Frank Kitty ahead of Scott Tucker, the 551 ahead of the 552. I don't think that's really going to end up in much of a battle, because Marino certainly has the speed on Scott Tucker. But in all the other classes, just tremendous. Four cars battling away in PC, six cars battling away in GT, and seven in GTC. And it was that number 10 car, must have made a pit stop, I think, because all of a sudden it went from leading during that caution to the tail end of that group. So it's now Degen Faulkner who'd taken over the lead, but now he's just been passed by Andy Lally in the number 27 for Patrick Dempsey and Alessandro Del Piero down to the turn 11.
That was a big show of the lights by Mr. Johnny, but there's that lap car there that he just really couldn't do anything with it once again. This is just brilliant stuff that's unfolding right now as we are coming up on 43 minutes remaining. And again, you see a couple of different looks to taking that Andretti hairpin. There are a couple of different lines you can run down there, and these guys are exploiting every one of them. And again, never ending. Multi-class sports car racing, part of that wonderful game of high-speed chess that we talk about. That traffic, you get through a group, and you got to do it all again. And Lure comes through, and Johnny this time not going to be able to get him in, but times it nicely, is able to get through, but that does give Lucas 2-3 car lengths. And right now, that's everything.
Yeah, that wasn't last very long.
No.
Going up the hill here, the five support traffic, if not the corkscrew, then farther round to the left. But there is the leader in PC as well, coming down the corkscrew now. Colin Brown about 15 car lengths ahead of Luis Diaz. And then we've got the two overall leaders. And then, I don't know, about another 2 or 3 seconds behind that, the third place car of PC for Bruno Junqueira. And about 3 seconds behind here is Kyle Marcelli for Bar 1 Motorsports. No word yet from race control about that incident involving number 05 car that brought out that previous caution period.
Wow, this is just great stuff. Here comes Lure coming up on Colin Brown. The LMP Challenge by Continental class leader Lure is through. And Johnny going to try and get him now here into turn three. They've cleared that little bit. And Colin Brown now can focus on staying in front of the very quick Luis Diaz in that number 52 car that is running up behind him as we are closing in on 40 minutes remaining in this race. Diaz through five. There's Johnny. Colin Brown and Lucas Lure leading him all the way up the hill. Here are your class leaders. We're going to step away for just a moment, and one more time, the drivers say hi to Mom.
Here we are, Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. It's Mother's Day this weekend, and I think it's important for me to say, Mama, I love you, and if it weren't for you, I would not be here. Happy Mother's Day.
Happy Mother's Day to my mom. I wish you were here. It's Laguna Seca. It's a great, great weekend, and I hope you're having a fantastic day. Go Core!
Everything we ever thought up. Everything we fight for. Everything we dream of. Everything we are. The 9/11. Porsche Identity.
Rated E for everyone.
We dream of speed, of pushing to the limit and beyond. We dream of racing the ghosts of history, of perfect passes and podium finishes. We dream to compete. We dream to win.
Xbox 360, starting at $99.
You did it.
You solved Corman's enigma. How did you do it, Professor?
Professor? No, I'm not a professor. I'm just here to see my daughter. She's a dance major. But I did stay at a Holiday Inn Express last night.
Stay smart. Stay at a Holiday Inn Express.
Deltran battery tender battery chargers. Just like the everyday consumer, the racing community knows the importance of a healthy charge. Deltran battery tender is the trusted charger for some of the most respected brands in the world today. Don't let a dead battery ruin your fun or work. If you can't start it, you can't drive it. Connect a Deltran battery tender battery charger to all of your batteries. Available at these fine retailers. If it's not a Deltran battery tender, it's just a pretender.
Welcome back, and ooh, damage to the right front corner of that Muscle Milk Picket Racing entry. Lucas Luhr, you can see bodywork flapping and giving a big gesture there to that car. He just came by, so you wonder if that wasn't one that perhaps he got into it with. He's still leading, but that's going to affect things. Let's take a look at what happened. Working traffic again, splitting these cars. Johnny throw.
He's not leading.
No.
He's not leading because
just showed it just happened then.
Yikes.
Oh, man.
Wow. They pretty much come to blows there, the two leaders, once again splitting another car. One of the Del Piero Patrick Dempsey cars, and heavy contact between the two. That's going to be an interesting discussion after the race. Certainly down the inside, you know, that's kind of a mirror image. One was on the inside, one was on the outside of another slower car going into the corner, but heavy contact between the number 12 and the number 6. Johnny does take over the lead once again.
Yep.
And you know, boy, this has been a tremendous battle between these two. It's you don't like to see it end in any sort of contact like that, certainly, but you know, Neil Johnny saw the opportunity to dive down the inside, and with the number 6 car so far over to the left of the track, it's hard to really judge where you are there. So boy, just forceful driving certainly from Neil Johnny, and Lucas Luhr certainly will feel aggrieved by that, but you know, it's good hard racing, I think, and you know, it's been a tremendous battle all the way through this event. The Neil Johnny has set the fastest lap of the race, a 113.9. It's interesting about that. The fastest lap of the race last year was set by Lucas Luhr, who's currently in second place, at a 115.5. This year, Lucas Luhr is at a 114.4, his fastest lap. So it's been a half a second slower than that Rebellion car that's now leading again. But wow, tremendous race going on here.
Yeah, left front. Think.
That's maybe a bit of foreshadowing. They're reading right now in the data, perhaps a left front puncture, and that would
not horrible.
That would have been in that Rebellion Toyota. That contact there, left to the right side of the Muscle Milk Picket car, and they've got all kinds of sensors. And obviously, at speed, you don't want that tire to suddenly go down. They're letting him know.
I think I heard Neil Johnny say not normal. There, which would indicate that perhaps he knows there's something amiss there. Last time around for Neil Johnny was a 1:19.8. Not sure whether that was a result of the accident or whether that was as a result of the fact he's slowing down because perhaps he has a puncture. It was certainly a heavy contact between those two in the air. Johnny's sliding around here an awful lot. That car is not indeed normal. So, and now Lucas Luhr is closing in once again. Damage or no damage to the right-hand side. Johnny off the road.
He doesn't yet. You can hear it. Left front.
Left front.
And as soon as he got to 10 and that loaded up, especially in that compression on that left front corner of the car, that tire pressure change, he was off. Oh my. What a shame. What an amazing battle to the run this could have been, Jamie.
Left front Michelin tire out and ready for Neil Johnny. The only people excited about this right now are Muscle Milk. built because they the lead, it was quick, but nonetheless, they lost this time on pit lane.
Wow, that's exactly right, Jamie. Rebellion Racing certainly pulled one over on Pickett Racing there during that pit stop, I think, but it was a very forceful manoeuvre there by Neil Gianni. It was a heavy contact between those two, and it would appear that the Rebellion car came off second best. They're punctured to the left front. He has to make that pit stop, and he's now lost, well, at least a half a lap to Lucas Neuhaus. Yep. Is there any damage to Lucas Neuhaus? I'm looking, judging by his last lap time, 115.9, perhaps not.
Yeah, we were kind of, you know, the way race control has been calling things, was that going to be some sort of an issue or not? Well, it's sort of self-served right here with that stop, so a bit of a problem at this point. Now, Jamie, what's the word on the damage on Muscle Mill?
Well, the team say the car is in good enough condition to get him to the end of this race and get him to cruise him, but over to the wall to watch as Lucas Neuhaus drove past. They're not going to bring him in. They're just going to let him fight to the checkered flag.
Well, really, I mean, that's the right play at this point. If the car seems to be pretty solid and there's no damage to the suspension or in terms, the only concern you have with that bodywork failing is if something rips off and then you lose downforce or something in a key part of the track. Now it's going to be interesting to see, one, what Neil Gianni can do in terms of just outright raw pace. But if we get a caution in this one yet, and we've seen plenty.
Certainly have. Six cautions, full course cautions so far, and you can see the damage to the bodywork on the number six car, Lucas Neuhaus, as he goes up the hill one more time through turn six. It doesn't seem to be slowing him down significantly, and hopefully it's not going to impinge upon anything else in that area of the car.
It's still Garcia leading in GT, but Sellers right there, less than half a second to drift. Another second back as Edwards, then a little bit of a gap now to Bell and Goosens. And here we go. Let's take a look at it. We're getting a report officially for race control. No action on the incident between Lucas Neuhaus and Neil Gianni. So again, I think it was sort of self-serving is the view they're taking right there. This is that battle. There you see Antonio Garcia, the yellow CompuWare Corvette. There's Brian Sellers and the 17 Falcon Tire Porsche. That is the 56 of John Edwards at your top three. They have gapped the guys behind him. Townsend Bell, Goosens, Holzer just a little bit. So these three right now are trying to settle it. And in the GT Challenge category right now, folks, you know, Jeroen Bleekenmolen, who was untouchable in qualifying, has been uber quick as his race has unfolded. But Andy Lally in the number 27 Dempsey Del Piero Tully's Coffee Porsche has come alive, and he has expanded the margin he had. Bleekenmolen was within 2 seconds, and Lally now has opened it up to 4 seconds, who in turn has another 4 seconds over Nick Tandy at this point. So Andy Lally, just a remarkable talent Andy Lally is, and continues to impress here as he stretches it out over Jeroen Bleekenmolen, Tandy, Faulkner, and Jan Halen completing the top five in that category. Watching the battle for fourth in GT right now. That is the number 23 Team West AJR battery tender Ferrari, and right behind him is that Fast and Furious 6 SRT Motorsports Viper, Mark Goosens. This is the duel for fourth. And there's a fairly large margin behind Goosens back to Marco Holzer. So these two guys are looking for fourth. The guys up front battling for third. And Lucas Lure making in the middle of this battle for fourth momentarily. See, you saw there, if Lucas would have been in the battle that he had been in earlier with Neil Gianni in that close spot stuff, he wouldn't have waited. He would have stoved it down the inside there, heading into turn four to get underneath Bell. Now with that big margin, he's got a hand officially some 35 seconds over Neil Gianni. He was able at that point, he could just wait, get out of that corner and go. Of course, now as I say that, he comes out of turn six. It almost goes completely off track to make the pass on John Edwards. Now he's going to swing the outside, or try to. Brian Sellers. It looked like Brian had dipped the brake a little bit to let him go, but Brian does not want to be too kind in these exchanges because he's got John Edwards right there, and this is the battle for second in GT. And you can see again, Antonio Garcia is able to open it up just a little bit here and drive away I tell you what, I think we're seeing a pretty good statement from BMW Rahal Letterman Lanigan as to their confidence in this newcomer to the team, relatively. His only other race started with him at Sebring in John Edwards. They like what he is doing, and they have left him in the car. And he has been up to the task in every conceivable way.
Yeah, hasn't he? Just doing a stellar job here this afternoon, he's just had a magnificent run. And look at Townsend Bell, too, running in fourth place there, and only 4 seconds off the lead. He's ahead of the Viper of Mark Goose, despite the damage to the left rear corner of that number 23 Ferrari we saw very early on in this race. Been a great run for Team West AJR.
There goes Garcia in the Corvette through the corkscrew, lapping one of our GT Challenge cars. Sellers now gets held up just for a moment. That is the Competition Motorsports AXA financial entry. Edwards works the outside, as does one of our P2 machines. I think that's Scott Sharp. After all the problems that they've had, they've been able to get out and stay running for a while. That's the good news. And for this team, we knew it was going to be one of those years. They had a great run, fortuitous, but still solid at Long Beach to the win. But this is a very different track, and they have encountered some different issues that they've been trying to solve and work with at this point. There's Garcia, top of your frame. Sellers, Sharp going to go by him relatively soon. It looks to me like Townsend Bell is actually starting to close in on John Edwards. What a story this would be. Townsend Bell, I think he's pretty good shape mentally right now. I understand he just recently landed a ride and will be back at the Indy 500. As we are under a half hour, 28 minutes to go right now.
Yeah, and certainly plenty to play for in several of the classes. This is the great battle going on here. John Edwards trying to track down now Brian Sellers, who indeed in turn is trying to track down Antonio Garcia. Antonio Garcia just trying to get his what would be just his second victory in the American Le Mans Series. He first came back in 2009 at Sebring. In the 12 hours there, weren't many cars in GT1 in those days, but he came away with the victory on that occasion. This would be his first win since, and if he can get this car through this final 27 minutes of this race, there's still plenty of time to go here. It's half a fuel stint effectively, and there's plenty of racing ahead of these guys. And in GTC, Andy Lally doing a fantastic job,
isn't he?
And maintaining that lead now over Jerome Blakemolle, and Nick Tandy also has moved his way up into third place ahead of Damien Faulkner. Once again, that TRG just really struggled this weekend. He did a good job to keep on the lead back, and Damien Faulkner actually led a few laps when we went back to green here, but no match as this race is unfolding. Slipped back from the lead into fourth place.
Right now, watch Edwards. He's trying to get by that TRG Porsche, and he got held up just a little bit, and he's able to slice through and make the pass. But closing up on the back of Edwards, there is, I think, a great story. That Team West Alex Job Racing Ferrari and battery tender William Rast entry is coming, and is coming quick. And look at that, too. Brian Sellers now suddenly has made up a fair chunk of ground on Antonio Garcia. Now we're going to head down to pit lane for an update here. All right. Oh, look at this. Sellers is making up a lot of ground suddenly in that battle for GT. He has closed up to within a car length on Antonio Garcia.
Yeah, we've got two or three car lengths covering each of the top four cars in GT. And I tell you what, Mark Goossens isn't far back either. He's closing in. Last time around was a 124.8 for Mark Goossens. He was the fastest of all of those five cars in GT. So that battle is very much ongoing. Bruno Junqueira making a pit stop out of fourth place in PC. That will not be a scheduled pit stop.
Well, one of those pieces of bodywork that was flailing on this car has finally just come off. If nothing else, less of a distraction for Lucas Lure. But I think he's pretty focused right now.
Yeah, he certainly is. And it seems quite extensive damage there to the right-hand side of the Muscle Milk car number six. It's obviously not affecting anything too critical at this stage. And right now, Lucas Lure will know that there's no way Neil Jarny can catch him. So all he needs to do is just turn, you know, some conservative laps through the final 24 minutes of this race, and he will come away with another win.
Yeah, they
sounds easy, doesn't it?
Yes. They didn't have the Sebring they wanted, but boy, did they have a great Long Beach. And while they didn't qualify where they wanted to here, I talked to Greg Pickett during the pre-race festivities as well, and he said, yeah, he said, we're not real thrilled with where we qualified, but we're pretty confident we've got a package to race with here. And they have done a brilliant job of it.
They certainly have. It's been the Rebellion car that's had the fastest lap of the race. We talked about that a little while ago. 113.9 compared to the 114.4 that Lucas Lure set in the number six car. But it's not always about pace.
Speaking of pace, Andy Lally is throwing it down here in the GT Challenge category. Last time we talked, his margin over Jerome Bleekemolen was 4 seconds. Well, right now Lally has 5.5 seconds, but it's over Nick Tandy, who has come back in that number 30 Momo NGT Motorsports machine. And Bleekemolen has slipped to third spot at this point. Faulkner sits fourth, and Andrew Davis in the number 10 Tully's car. The team went, so boy, what a great, if it were to finish like this, Dempsey Del Piero would have two cars in the top five in GT Challenge. And let's take a look and see what unfolded right here. Oh, we went to the outside.
That's the TRG car.
Yeah.
Oh, I guess that's, was that the restart when he took the lead from Damien Faulkner? Okay, fair enough, yeah. Andy Lally taking the lead of the car from Damien Faulkner when we went back to green. Yes. That was about 15, 20 minutes ago.
Yep.
There is Andy Lally now. We've asked whether Patrick Dempsey would like to have a chat to one of our pit reporters. He's politely declined an opportunity. He doesn't want to jinx his team, which is potentially here looking at can I say the word?
W. Let's go W.
W, right.
Yeah, there he is. Just look at that look. That says it all. Yeah, they went to him and said, you know, we'd like to chat, and he said, no.
He would have declined at least with grace, no question.
Oh, without a doubt.
But what a day it's been there for this Tully's Confidence machine. Andy Lally, he's been stellar all weekend long. He's always started out each of the sessions, goes to the top of the charts right away, then he hands over to Patrick Dempsey, who each time has run most of the sessions, most of the track time to get himself up to speed, to get himself more and more familiar with this car. It's been a tremendous drive by both of them this afternoon thus far.
So there's Lally, who, as you said, has just been brilliant today for sure. Now, keep in mind, folks, last month, players from across the world competed online in Forza Motorsport 4 to set the fastest lap time. Now, there is a handle that they use, so gamer GDLR Lage raced his Team Falcon 17 Porsche RSR to victory. This month, players will be racing on Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca in the legendary Mazda 787B four-rotor. You can check it out at ForzaMotorsports.net and ALMS.com. So give that a check, and congratulations to gamer GDLR Lage. Well done. Here's your leaders in each of the categories as we are closing in on the end of this one. Under 20 minutes to go here at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca, round three of the American Le Mans Series presented by Tequila Patron. It is the American Le Mans Monterey, and that is your leader in GT. There is your leader in GT Challenge, and right by him now comes Brian Sellers down to the inside, sitting second in that Falcon Tire Porsche in GT. John Edwards in that BMW sits third in GT as he sneaks by as well. Fourth is now Mark Goossens has made the pass in the number 91 SRT Viper. Boy, what a great story that is. And then sitting down in fifth is Townsend Bell as well. A great story in that Team West AJR entry. There's your leader in the LMP Challenge category, Colin Brown, running as we have seen this year. Boy, I'll tell you, these LMP Challenge cars have been very, very impressive. Tip overall.
Yeah, very good indeed. And he's only got maybe a couple of seconds over Luis Diaz, the same order these two ran in at Long Beach 3 weeks ago. On that occasion, Colin Brown was able to stretch his fuel to the limit, much to the surprise of several of his rivals, because he managed to do about 7 or 8 more laps on a tank of fuel than did anybody else. But the system has been the rules for clarification, by the way, on how much and how you size your fuel cell. But hey, no harm, no foul. You know, they got the victory there. Colin Brown once again having to work hard here. Luis Diaz pushing him hard, a little bit quicker last time around. The traffic there for the number 05 car on Colin Brown.
Is it me, or does the back of that AJR Team West Ferrari look like that damage is a little bit worse? A little bit more of that back empty. That may have just come loose. It had been damaged earlier. All right, now let's see what unfolds here as the Corvette of Garcia and these guys right now have a little bit of clear track in front of them. It's just down to pace at this point.
It is. And Mark Houston, he's been the fastest car on the track in GT for the last several laps here. He's got past Townsend Bell. He's only about just over a second or so behind the third place car of John Edwards. As you can see the Delta Wing struggling down the hill.
Making it into pit lane. Sketchy place right at the exit of 10. Cars tracking out. And just. At least it's a downhill coast if you can make it get into the pits.
Yeah, hopefully that will happen. There is Brian Sellers there still. Second and a half or so behind the Corvette, and a similar margin, less ahead of the BMW. And then on the BMW's tail, actually, looks like Mark Goose's cost a little bit on that last lap, so he's got a bit more of a deficit to make up for that Delta Wing going painfully slowly.
Yeah.
I'm not sure it's going to make the pit lane.
Well, and worse still, if it makes pit lane and stops and blocks the pit lane, that becomes an issue as well. Now, I can think of one person who would be delighted if we had one last caution. My name is Johnny.
Yeah, that's right, isn't it?
He might be the one, but it.
Even if there is a caution, there's going to be some traffic between those two cars. I think he's half a lap behind. It's going to be a tall order for him to make up, pass all the cars between himself and Lucas Neuer. There won't be very much time remaining. Down inside 16 minutes now to go in this motor race.
Well, while we may be realists, I believe race car drivers tend to be optimists.
Very true. It's sad to see Bruno Junqueira slipping down the order. That RSR car started very, very well by Duncan Endy. Bruno Junqueira into the pits probably 5 or 6 laps ago now, and still on the pit lane. Whoa, there's Lucas Neuer off the road trying to get past the traffic.
He's done that a couple of times. He shows no qualms about getting all four off to the left there coming up that hill.
It's pretty smooth though. It's a bit dusty, but it is pretty smooth. Well graded. Like a rally road, I guess.
Exactly. Now, this time of a 4-hour race, it's just dusty.
Yeah.
Yeah, it's how it is. Ooh. Boy, Colin Brown just right now going, well, Lucas is going to open the door. I'm going to try and scoot through because I want to keep Diaz buried in some traffic.
But look at the BMW is right on Brian Sellers' tail coming through turn 11 that time. Mark Goosen still under pressure now. Townsend Bell, who's right in the mix there. This battle for fourth and fifth. Battle for second and third and fourth and fifth in GT. Antonio Garcia, the last few laps, has managed to eke out an advantage of almost 3 seconds over Brian Sellers. So it's certainly a good move by him to be able to have done that. But that battle still for fourth and fifth is ongoing.
Yeah, it wasn't that long ago we were talking about Sellers had run him down, and it was within a car length, and Garcia has upped his game noticeably. There's Sellers right behind Diaz, the two second place cars, the prototype and challenge, and Sellers in GT, then Edwards in the BMW. Let's see. Well, at the stripe, not a lot between Colin Brown and Luis Diaz. But now these exchanges have been close. And look at Edwards all over the back of Brian Sellers here. just over 13 minutes remaining.
Yes, a very impressive job by John Edwards. He didn't have a lot of seat time in the BMW Z4 GTE. Driven at Sebring, of course. Hasn't driven it since then. He's been busy with his Rolex GT commitment. Yeah. So I'm pretty sure he hasn't been in the car at all since Sebring.
Good getting through traffic there, babe.
But boy, he's been stellar this weekend. He's been right on the pace right from the very get-go and is now putting the pressure still on Brian Sellers, fighting for second place in GT.
You hear the crew calling in. Nice job in traffic there.
Full course caution, pack up.
Oh my, we have a full course caution, and you would think, there it is, the Delta Wing. Now some smoke emanating from the back of that car. So some issues.
The whole goal for that team, Dave Price leading that operation now, was to get to the end of the race and to come within 12 minutes of it. And end ignominiously like that is a real disappointment for the entire team of boys and girls. Catherine Legg, of course, sharing the car with Andy Merrick this weekend. Her second drive in a sports car. She drove in the 2007 Daytona 24 Hours. This is her first sports car race since then. And Dave Price has been very impressed with Catherine, with her approach, with her feedback, with her technical knowledge, with her speed as well. And yes, you know, it's a very early period of this gestation of this Delta Wing with its new engine and tire package. But it's at least the car has run well moderately well in the race. They've had problems all the way through the weekend. It has completed here over 100 laps, and you know, that's certainly a feather, I think, in the caps of all the teams at Delta Wing Racing Cars.
Absolutely, continuing. It was a huge conversion for that car, for lack of a better term. You know, taking out the power plant that had been in it, completely different tires. At the same time, working on a bespoke chassis for the coupe that they are hoping to debut. This car, the one that's currently running, based on an AMR-1, the Aston Martin Racing 1 prototype chassis. The new one they're working on for the coupe is the complete new designed in-house chassis. So it's a lot going on there. And I think this was more, they just wanted to run the car, get that engine, which is a huge program in and of itself.
Yeah, and the new Delta Wing Coupe is supposed to be, the chassis is supposed to go for its mandatory crash tests, I think at the end of next week, actually. And they're hoping to have the first on-track tests within a month or so. And they're hoping to see that car on track for the first race, perhaps at Road America, Elkhart Lake, Wisconsin. That's the goal at the moment. They'll see how the testing goes. But in the meantime, they're going to continue with this project, certainly.
All right. Well, as we're continuing around under caution, we've got a great run up front by Antonio Garcia, and I think Jamie's found his teammate.
Well, here at Corvette Racing, it's like mission control with all the monitors. Dan Binks on the radio with Antonio Garcia right now, practically calling him around the entire racetrack. Dan watches the whole thing, but the whole team is watching right now, including Yann Magnussen. Yann, it's nail-biting right now. We're back under full course caution. We're going to go back to green with not much time left. What's it like to know that your race win is in the hands of a co-driver?
Well, that doesn't bother me too much. Antonio's a fantastic guy, but the whole situation with 10 minutes to go, and we've just gotten a little bit of a gap to, not that we could relax or anything, but we could kind of drive our own race and not worry so much about holding the Porsche back. So we'll see. Hopefully we can get a good gap immediately after the safety car and bring home a win.
When you were in the car, it was still pretty warm outside. Temperatures have dropped right now. In the practice sessions this week, how was the Corvette in the cooler temps?
The balance was pretty good, both the cold and the hot, so I'm not so worried about that. It's more that we are right at the end of the stint on tires, so everybody's got really worn tires, and I think it's the first time that in this race that we run a set of tires this one, so it's a little bit of a question mark, but you know, Antonio's doing great before the safety car, and hopefully he can keep the tires clean, keep them warm, and get going.
You heard Yann Magnussen say, finally get a win. It's been so long, I don't even remember, guys, when the last win was. Justin?
Here right now with Bill Sweeter. Bill, all week, first of all, I want to say that congratulations, because I think your pace this week has been as close as any pairing could be in the Ferrari, so we're very proud of what you've done, so great job. But the car's running really well right now, isn't it? And of course, Townsend looks like he's had the bit in his teeth for the last hour or so.
Yes, he's getting ready for the Indy 500, so he's got the eye right now. But I got to tell you something, this car, the Ferrari, on Yokohama's has been unbelievable. And frankly, the Motegi rims that we have, just spectacular with battery tender. We're just thrilled for our whole outfit here. So Townsend, everyone's rooting him on right now. And hey, you got a little background with him, so it'd be nice to see him get up there.
I know when he gets focused on something, you better stand clear. But the other thing is that we have talked about all through the broadcast, the Yokohamas seem to really enjoy this operating range, temperature range that we're heading to right now. So this yellow for you, I'm sure the whole team is thinking, is a pretty good thing.
Yeah, I mean, every degree that the track drops, the Yokohamas get that much better. So we're very excited going in here. I must tell you, Yokohama's put a lot of development into the tires, and frankly, they're great. I heard earlier someone mention that they don't perform as well in warm weather. These guys have done a gang-up job making them perform, so we're going into June right now, doing a lot more development. We're looking forward to Lime Rock.
Well, good. I think it's ready, aim, fire with Townsend right now. So we'll look forward to the green. Thanks.
Thanks, Justin.
And I think that's a good point. But remember as well that they also did that wing change on the back of the car as well. And that may be coming into it with the, if they're running a little bit more wing, a little bit more grip.
And we've seen all weekend long that right off the bat, as soon as we go at the beginning of a session, that car is lightning fast. It really gets the heat into the tires much quicker, it seems, than just about anything else. So, Townsend's got a good game plan here. He's in a good position, and who knows, he might even spring a major surprise, because he loves this racetrack. He's from San Luis Obispo, just down the coast a little bit. He won his clinched his Indy Lights championship right here at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca back in 2001. So he just loves this place. He knows the car is great. He's super confident in it. He's going to give it a charge these last few laps, no question.
And why not? Just let's do it and go after it and see what happens. I'm trying to figure out where in this queue is the Rebellion Toyota. I mean, Lure is sitting out front. There it is. So one, two, three, four, about 10 cars that he'd have to work his way by. And Lure's got clear track.
He's got to work his way past all those GT leaders as well, hasn't he? They're going to be rather busy with their own little contest going on. But Jan Magnussen, boy, Jamie talking to him there, and he's had a remarkable career in the American Motor Series from 99 all the way through 2011. He won a race, at least one race every single year. That record streak was broken last year, and Jamie said she couldn't remember when his last win was. It was at Canadian Tire Motorsport Park, formerly known as Motorsport, in 2011. But he's chewing all his fingernails right now, isn't he?
And Jamie was talking about Danny Binks talking to Antonio with all kinds of information. Well, that was the guy who was just off to Jan's left with the fireproof balaclava, but was on that radio talking. And Danny Binks is one of the great communicators in pit lane. He's got an eye, and he can spot stuff, and he keeps that driver informed. And I remember it was a number of years ago, Ron Fellows, back in the year the Maseratis were running, and Ron Fellows went from like fifth to the lead in one lap on a restart, and it was just Binksy spotting for him, telling him he was clear. It was just incredible right here. It's pretty impressive the way that Corvette Racing team
operates. That's exactly what Townsend Bell is planning to do right
yeah,
now.
Exactly.
Unfortunately, we're still not yet going back to green, are we? It's taking a bit longer than they'd hoped, I'm sure, to get that Delta Wing car out of the way. Hopeful that in one more lap we'll be able to go back to green flag, and then it'll be about
two laps, maybe.
Yeah, maybe a couple of laps only. Yeah,
we're at just a little over 4 minutes. Yeah, this is going to be fierce. And we get word that the number 27 in the GT Challenge category has gone to the lead with a really strong run. Andy Lally has gone to the front, been very impressive. Tandy sits second, Bleekemolen third, Faulkner fourth, Jan Halen fifth in that GT Challenge category, and Andrew Davis now sixth, but still in all. Dempsey Del Piero sitting with two cars in the top six right now. I think Andy Lally is pretty glad to be back in this team. He had to miss Long Beach And I think that not that it takes a lot to light his fire when he wants to drive a race car fast, but he came in well motivated to be sure.
Yeah, absolutely right. You know, he's another guy who's had a fair bit of success here at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca. He's had four top three finishes in the Rolex GT series here at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca, including a win in 2007. He's a three-time Rolex GT champion, four-time winner of the Rolex 24 Hours at Daytona. So, you know, he's used to wins, and he's won here in the American Le Mans Series, won in the American Le Mans Series before, but this would be a big win for him. The good news is, particularly, he has the cushion, at least, of one car in between himself and the second place car in GTC, which is driven by Nick Tandy.
And the way that they're acting, it looks like I wonder if we're going to be going. The lights are out, so right there, folks. We were just talking about him, and it turns out he is going to be your battery tender hard charger in this race, and an absolutely great job for that program, and a good, great effort, of course, by Andy Lally coming up through the pack like that and putting it up front. So well done to MC Del Piero Racing and Andy Lally, the battery tender hard charger here in round three. And we're getting the green and white together.
Green.
Oh, it's somebody off already. There goes Lucas Luhr. And GT, this is going to be furious. There's Lucas. I think that may have been, was that Colin Brown that went off at the exit? Because that looks like Diaz is now leading. Boy, he dropped back, and look at this move right now. Brian Sellers all over the back of Garcia, and they've split from Edwards. We've got prototypes in between those two cars. It's going to be Sellers taking a little peek, not there.
And Mark Goosens ushered Townsend Bell off the racetrack there in turn three on the exit. They were side by side going through the corner. Here is Neil Gianni trying to find his way past Antonio Garcia, lets him go, and there is Colin Brown with Brian Sellers, who's trying to get the lead in GT right in the middle of them. So boy, this is fraught, but you're right. Colin Brown did lose the lead, apparently, of PC at that restart.
Yeah, and I don't know whether he got helped off, but suddenly he just shot off track and cost him the lead. There is Sellers. But now Garcia, with that car in between he and Sellers, has that bit of a cushion. Now the only thing that could change it is if Colin Brown parks him a little
nice
bit.
Lucas
Luhr brings it home. A huge win. Just a great drive. Some absolutely phenomenal racing. Here we go. Garcia out of the last turn. He's going to bring it home. Look
great
at Edwards.
Job.
Close up on the back of Sellers.
We needed that big time. Woo!
Not quite enough. Fuck. And the number three Corvette team is elated over the moon with that incredible run. And he brought it home. Wow. But now let's take a look at the restart here. We're going to go from the high shot. Keep in mind, there's Colin Brown in that second spot. He just pushed wide.
Wow.
Into the grass. There goes Diaz, that blue car up at the top of your frame. He went into the lead. Here's another angle on it, Jeremy.
Yeah, Colin Brown just trying to get an early jump on the restart. Just carries too much, gets on the throttle a bit too soon. Cold tires. It's much cooler now than it was earlier on. And a mistake there from Colin Brown. And he gives away the lead in PC after a little bit of a tremendous run for himself, John Bennett. He didn't involve anybody else there. It was a mistake completely on his own. He'll be kicking himself, of course, but at least no one else was involved. He didn't involve any of the other class leaders either.
Yeah, absolutely. Wow. Well, it was fierce. There are your class provisional winners, Luhr, Franchitti, Diaz, Garcia, and Nick Tandy.
Everything we ever thought up. Everything we fight for. Everything we dream of. Everything we are. The 911. Porsche Identity.
Rated E for everyone.
We dream of speed, of pushing to the limit and beyond. We dream of racing the ghosts of history, of perfect passes and podium finishes. We dream to compete. We dream to win.
Xbox 360, starting at $99.
You did it.
You solved Corman's enigma.
How did you do it, Professor?
Professor? No, I'm not a professor. I'm just here to see my daughter. She's a dance major. But I did stay at a Holiday Inn Express last night.
Stay smart. Stay at a Holiday Inn Express.
Deltran battery tender battery chargers. Just like the everyday consumer, the racing community knows the importance of a healthy charge. Deltran battery tender is the trusted charger for some of the most respected brands in the world today. Don't let a dead battery ruin your fun or work. If you can't start it, you can't drive it. Connect a Deltran battery tender battery charger to all of your batteries. Available at these fine retailers. If it's not a Deltran battery tender, it's just a pretender.
ESPN coverage of the American Le Mans Monterey is brought to you by Continental Tire. Innovative technology, driving confidence. VP Racing Fuels, our passion is making power. Tequila Patron, simply perfect.
Boy, that was a thriller there. It's Lucas Lure and Klaus Graf who come away with the victory in P1 ahead of Nick Heidfeld and Neil Jani. So Nick Heidfeld's birthday yesterday, not able to turn that into a pole, into a victory today. Catherine Legg and Andy Merrick come away with third place in the P1 class. That was one of their two goals coming into today. One was to get on the podium. The second one was to finish the race. They didn't quite finish the race, but they did at least get onto the podium because of the problems very early in the race once again for Dyson Racing. It's been a tremendous day of racing here. We've had rather too many cautions perhaps than we would have liked, but some fantastic racing from the drop of the green flag all the way down to the finish of the race. There's a great aerial view of Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca, one of the great racetracks in North America, if not the world. It's a track that everybody looks forward to coming to. There is our winning team, and it's Klaus Graf and Lucas Lure. Lucas only drove 15 minutes at Long Beach a few weeks ago. Came away with the victory. This time he's driven a lot more of the race and gets another well-deserved visit to victory lane for Muscle Milk Picket Racing. Taking a well-deserved sip of water, I think, is Lucas Lure. He really has earned that this afternoon. And Jamie Howe is with that team.
Big congratulations all around for Lucas Lure, Klaus Graf. Lucas Lure, this was a team effort. You guys worked so hard. How rewarding is it when it comes down like this?
I mean, we weren't by far the quickest car, but we did good in traffic and on the strategy side. And I had to push everything I've got, you know, there was nothing left. But also, in the beginning, Klaus did a great job. Thanks to Greg, Muscle Milk, great day, awesome.
Congratulations, guys.
Greg Pickett on top of the car, thanks, Jamie. A tremendous effort by these guys today. And let's have a look at our GT results. After another thrilling contest, we knew this was going to be a tight one going into the race. It came all the way down to the end of the race. The first win for Jan Magnussen since 2011, for Antonio Garcia since 2009. And Corvette Racing comes away with another victory. Let's go down to victory lane.
Jan and Antonio, fantastic. As they say, the harder the trials, the better the spoils. You have really deserved this for the three car. Antonio, what a great last stint you had.
I mean, it was mega. I mean, Jan did a really good job to start with. I mean, he put the car right on front right away. And then the Corvette guys did a magnificent job in the pits. So even if everything went down to little seconds, like a driver chance needed to be below 20 seconds, everything worked perfect, so I'm really happy, very proud for the Corvette team, and finally, after 1.5 years, I got this victory.
Tremendous effort by both of those two. Jan Magnussen there, a well-deserved victory for him as well. He started off that race. Let's have a look at the results in P2. It's Level 5 Motorsports after the disappointments at Long Beach 3 weeks ago. Bounce back here with another 1-2 finish. It is the 551 car. Scott Tucker sharing with Marino Franchitti. And Jamie Howe is with the Scotsman.
Well, Marino Franchitti obviously tired after that long stint that he did. But Marino, you're also not feeling well. You're getting sick as you're getting out of the car. How rewarding is it, though, knowing that you get to go up on the podium?
Yeah, definitely. That was what was keeping me going. I felt awful from the moment I got in the car. I felt good up until then, and I've just been trying not to throw up for the last sort of 2 hours. But physically, I feel fine, just apart from that. But congratulations to Level 5 guys. Thanks to Scott Tucker and to David Stone for having me here and allowing me to be part of this team. To rebound from Long Beach with a 1-2 like this is exactly what we needed, especially going into the big one at Le Mans. And I'd just love to see this car in the same place at 4 o'clock on Sunday in France as well.
It's pure determination that got you through this one. Congratulations.
Thank you.
Yeah, win number 7 for Marino Franchitti, win number 20 for Scott Tucker in the America Le Mans Series. In PC by Continental Tire, a great win for Michael Gouache and Luis Diaz, the second victory in a row for PR1 Matheson Motorsports. A mistake there right at the end of the race for Colin Brown loses the advantage for Core Autosport. He and John Bennett have to make do with second place. But what about that in third place? The youngest driver in the field, Tristan Nunez, sharing the number 18 car with Charlie Shears.
Firstly, congratulations both of you, Michael and Luis. But Luis, after all these years of racing, you still know that you have to keep the pressure, the hammer down right until the last corner. That was amazing.
Yeah, I mean, you know, it was a great fight with Colin. I respect him a lot as a driver, but I was keeping the pressure, you know, and this doesn't end up till the checkered flag is down. So I'm very proud of PR1. Michael Walsh did a great job. This is his home track. So very happy for all the PR1 guys.
Great job. So maybe you can make it 3 in a row. Who knows? Well done.
Yeah, PR1 Matheson Motorsports, also based in California, in Fresno. Tremendous result for those guys. In GTC, Dempsey Del Piero Racing led until the very last lap. And for the second weekend in a row, it's going to be the Momo NGT Motorsport squad that comes away with the victory. Let's have a look and see what happened. Andy Lally was leading at the restart, but on board here with the NGT car of Nick Tandy, able to make the move into turn 5, and it'll be a second victory in a row for Enrique Cisneros and the first ever win in the American Le Mans Series for Nick Tandy. Jamie Howe is with them.
Well, the look on Nick's face, a little bit of excitement, a little bit of surprise. Nick, on the last lap, talk us through it from your seat.
Yeah, I mean, that was absolutely the plan, even from the first practice, make the race a real good one and just take it on the last lap. But we had a couple of incidents in the pit lane, speeding penalties for some reason. We have no idea why. But we had really, really good pace in the car, and that was the big thing at the end of the day. And I was able to look after the tyres, have good pace. I was able to make moves, which was the big thing. And then obviously we had the restart at the end, and it just put me on the back of Andy, and I just had to go for it.
Congratulations to you, to Enrique Cisneros, and to Momo NGT. Job well done, guys.
It certainly was, Jamie, and a tremendous performance by those guys. A tremendously exciting race from start to finish. Let's have a look at the Michelin Green X Challenge, which rewards clean, fast, and efficiency. In the prototype class, it's Rebellion Racing. They have to make do with second place on the road, but they do get the victory in the Michelin Green X Challenge ahead of number 6 car. In GT, Team West, Alex Job Racing, what a day it has been for them. The number 23 car, Bill Swedler and Townsend Bell. They had a magnificent run to fourth place, the best ever result for that team. And they win the GT class of the Michelin Green X Challenge ahead of Corvette Racing and BMW Team RLL. They took the first and third places on the road. It's been a tremendous day for these guys. We're going to go off to the Le Mans break now, but we will come back for the American Le Mans Series presented by Tequila Patron on July 6th at Lime Rock Park for the Northeast Grand Prix in Northern Connecticut. That's going to be an exciting race, a very short racetrack, just a mile and a half around. Always a tremendously exciting event. We've had a great day here at Mazda Raceway Laguna Seca, and it's been, I think, excitement from start to finish. There's been no shortage of action on and off the track. My name is Jeremy Shaw. My thanks to Greg Creamer and in the pit lane to Jamie Howe and Justin Bell. Thanks for joining us. We'll see you again when we get back for Lime Rock Park.